Welcome back. We are going to study tertiary structure of proteins. In the previous classes, we completed the different types of secondary structure. What is a tertiary structure? It includes the three-dimensional arrangement of all the atoms in the protein, including those of the side chains and those of the backbone and those of any prosthetic groups attached with the proteins. So you know that a protein is made up of amino acids. Sometimes the protein may contain non-amino acid residues. All those atoms are arranged in a particular three-dimensional form, and that structure is called tertiary structure. What you see in this figure is myoglobin. Myoglobin is actually a single chain, single residue, single polypeptide chain. It is folded in a particular manner. You can see the particular manner in which this polypeptide chain is folded. It has a C-terminal end and an N-terminal end. And you can see the metal ion attached with it using coordinate covalent bond. The three-dimensional arrangement of all these things is together what is called tertiary structure. What you see here is the tertiary structure of myoglobin. And here what you see is the tertiary structure of alpha-lactalbumin. This is the C-terminal end. It is bent and it is folding in a particular form. And here you can see there is an N-terminal end. In some places, it actually consists of an alpha helix. Here there is an alpha helix, and here also there is an alpha helix. In some other places, it constitutes a beta pleated sheet. This is actually anti-parallel beta pleated sheet. So, in tertiary structure, some part of the polypeptide chain may have an alpha helix. Some other part of the polypeptide chain may have beta pleated sheets. It's a combination of all those things. This is what is called tertiary structure. And this is a hemoglobin subunit. Remember, tertiary structure is there for every polypeptide chain. Actually, hemoglobin consists of more than one polypeptide chain. And when we study the tertiary structure, we should consider only any one of the polypeptide chain. You can see in this beta subunit of the hemoglobin, here what you see is alpha helix. Here you can see another alpha helix, a third helix, a fourth helix, a fifth helix, like that. While here in this figure you can see myo-heme-erythrin. Here also you can see alpha helical structures. So in these two examples, there is a substantial amount of alpha helix in the structure. But remember, all proteins are not like that. Here, this is the model of hemoglobin. Helical regions are very clear. The helical regions in this figure actually are very clear. This is actually a fluorescent diagram obtained from the microscope, and it is modified using computers. Artificially color is given using computers. And what are the different forces that stabilize the structure of proteins? Some of the forces are covalent bonds. Some others are non-covalent bonds. For example, you know that the primary structure is stabilized by peptide bond, and peptide bond is a covalent bond. While disulfide bonds are there, they are covalent bonds formed between cysteines. You know that cysteine is an amino acid. And cysteine is containing actually SH in their R group. The SH group of one cysteine residue in one chain is forming a disulfide link, disulfide bridge with the SH group of cysteine residue of another chain. or different parts of the same chain. This is important in the formation of tertiary structure, not in the formation of secondary, not in the formation of a primary or secondary structure. You see, conformation of the backbone, it is a secondary structure. Position of all atoms in the protein, that is a tertiary structure. And interaction of the different subunits, different polypeptide chains in a protein, that is the quaternary structure, all are dependent upon non-covalent interactions. So, stabilization of the secondary structure, stabilization of the tertiary structure, and stabilization of the quaternary structure, all are dependent upon non-covalent interactions. And these non-covalent forces actually contribute to the most stable structure of the protein. When is the structure of the protein most stable? When it has the lowest of the energy levels possible. As the energy level decreases, stability increases. So the most stable form of protein or any other molecule is the one which has the least amount of energy associated with it. So it is the most stable form. What are the different types of non-covalent interactions? One interaction is hydrogen bonding. Hydrogen bonding, backbone hydrogen bonding, is a major determinant of secondary structure. What is actually backbone hydrogen bonding? You know that the backbone in the secondary structure consists of a carboxyl O, CO group, and also NH group. The CO group of one chain may engage in hydrogen bond formation with the NH group of another chain or with a different part of the same chain. We found this in the previous classes that this is important in the formation of alpha helix and also beta sheet. While hydrogen bonds between side chains of amino acid, between R groups of amino acids, are very much important in the stabilization of their structure. While non-polar residues tend to cluster together in the interior of a protein molecule during protein folding. This is because of hydrophobic interactions, because water-hating molecules have a tendency to come together in an environment where there is no water. Inside the protein molecule, inside the core of the three-dimensional protein molecule, there is no water. Such a molecule actually avoids water. And in that region, all the hydrophobic regions of the proteins are coming together. At the same time, the hydrophilic regions of the amino acids of the R groups are coming together on the exterior of the protein molecule so that they can interact very well with the outer hydrophilic, outer aqueous environment. So that's also electrostatic attraction. You see here, electrostatic attraction between oppositely charged groups, which frequently occurs on the surface of molecule, result in such groups being closed together. They are coming together with each other. So electrostatic attraction between positive groups and negative groups are there in the biomolecules. They are very important, and such parts of the molecule have a tendency to come together. And this is also related with the folding of the protein molecule. Then several side chains of the proteins have a tendency to complex with the metal ion. For example, you have studied the case of hemoglobin by means of coordinate covalent bonds. You see, such metal ions are also present in the form of prosthetic groups. See, iron and zinc are the most commonly occurring metallic ions in association with the proteins. And they interact with either cysteine or histidine. They form coordinate covalent bonds. And a zinc-mediated tertiary structure in DNA-binding proteins is commonly called zinc finger. Zinc finger is a zinc-mediated tertiary structure in DNA-binding proteins. And the zinc fingers contain four coordination sites to the proteins through two cysteine and two histidine residues. You will come across with these topics later. Anyway, You just understand now that in many cases proteins are associated with metal ions. These two are actually engaged in coordinate covalent bonds, and these bonds have very important roles in stabilizing the tertiary and also the quaternary structure, the three-dimensional structure of the protein molecules. This is actually a zinc finger domain of a DNA binding protein. You can see this is a zinc ion, zinc 2 plus ion. Here histidine 1, histidine 2, cysteine 1, cysteine 2. You see the polypeptide chain is folding and bending such that these four residues are coming in close proximity with the zinc ion. This is an example of zinc finger domain. And this is another example. This is the role of the disulfide bond. This is a disulfide bond formed between two parts of the same polypeptide chain. This is another disulfide bond. This is the Brazilian scorpion TS1 neurotoxin. This consists of only 61 amino acids and four disulfide bridges are there. Two of these bridges, disulfide linkages, connect the single alpha helix to one of the beta strands, while the other two linkages hold the loop portions in planes. So disulfide bridges are common. They are common in secreted proteins, which are found in oxidizing environments such as toxins, growth factors, and also hormones. You just think the case of our hormone insulin. So they are all secreted proteins. They are important in stabilization of the tertiary structure. Remember, when there is only one polypeptide chain, there is only up to the tertiary structure. Quaternary structure is not there. So in the stabilization of that structure, disulfide bonds, disulfide bridges or linkages are very much important. Here again you can see helical structure is there, beta plate sheet is there, metal ion is there, disulfide bridges are there. All the types of bonds we studied so far, you see hydrogen bonding is there, electrostatic attraction between the negative and the positive regions are there. So all these are the different types of linkages or attractions that stabilize the tertiary structure of proteins. This is the structure of myoglobin. You found this earlier in the first slide of this class. This is the different part of that polypeptide chain coming together because of different types of attractions. Now we are moving on to the quaternary structure.